Hi, welcome to my show where I get to interview really interesting people who have interesting stories, and I just so happen to also know them, luckily for me. And today I have with me Janice Seeley. Hey Janice, how are you?
Good, how are you? Thanks so much for having me.
Oh, you're welcome. And you are here because you are the conference and retreat manager at Columbia.
Yes.
Okay. And we are having a retreat on October 5th. I know that sounds like I can't even remember it. It's called, we're having a retreat that is from October 5th to the 7th, a 3-day retreat at Columbia.
Yes.
And somebody referred the retreat to us. So I went with Reverend Bart Yarnell and another person, Lisa Argo, and to check it out. And then when we got there, I have to show a picture of this because I think this place is so beautiful. Let me find more of a modern one. There it is. So when I got there, I remembered that I've been here before because as a journalist, I was assigned to cover a story a few years before that where there was a group of Chaldeans that were doing something similar. It was like a spiritual retreat, but it was a conference, I believe. I believe it might have been just for one day. But one of the memories that I had of the place, first of all, I really enjoyed the atmosphere there. It is so calm and relaxing. And I know that when I was interviewing some of the people that were part of the retreat, I was sitting in the cafeteria area and I'm looking and then I see this beautiful, you have these long like yards of and grass and trees. And I saw a nun or a couple of them, I think, were walking around. And I don't know, something about that, I really enjoyed it. And the other thing was the main chapel, which isn't this beautiful? I attended beautiful. Mass, mm-hmm. And it's really breathtaking. So I remember Reverend Yarnell and myself and Lisa, this was the first time they were there, but the place had the same type of effect on them, and we said, this is it. This is the place that we didn't even end up going anywhere else to look around, and then we ended up, and plus you were very lovely, really just showing us around, and you're very helpful. But then I go home, and we're putting the brochures together for it's a writing and spiritual retreat, because myself as an author, really the spiritual aspect of me I found has been so important for me to develop my writing. So we wanted to combine that, and we just found it so, like, such a peaceful place that we can do something like this there. The way you had there's different, the setup with the different rooms were really nice, and there's I'll show pictures of the labyrinth that we could do over there, rooms where we can do meditation and yoga. But these are the rooms. It just feels like just a very nice way to kind of just isolate yourself from the world.
Yes, there's no distractions, no TVs, no phones, so really, the overnight rooms that we have 125 overnight rooms. Because Columbia opened up as a college back in 1959, the rooms are a dormitory in style. We have the classrooms, which are now meeting spaces. We have about 17 total, which we work with the groups and, asking them how they want each room to be set. And
well,
it's just...
This is what I was going to say. Yeah. When I got to researching about Columbia and found out the history, I fell in love more with it. And yes, please tell us the history of what it was before. Well, now it's still utilized, but in a different way. But if you can kind of just tell the story.
Sure. Yeah. So it did open in 1959 as a Jesuit college. And a Jesuit essentially means that they're members of the Society of Jesus, which is a religious congregation of the Catholic Church. It was originated back in the 16th century in Spain. So the members of the society, they do a lot of missionary work, to Jesuit work in education, founding schools, universities, colleges, and seminaries. And they also do a lot of work administering in hospitals, with the poor, and also a variety of different parishes as well. So it opened in 1959 as a Jesuit training facility, a four-year program. The first 2 years were the novitiate, which is basically they're introduced to the Jesuit rule of life. They go through a 30-day retreat, living in silence, meditation, and prayer. And they also do a lot of work throughout the college, from secretarial work to gardening to working in the kitchen. And then the second two-year program is the juniorate, which they occupy themselves in studies from English, Latin, Greek literature, to French, public speaking. And then after that, they decide where they want to go with their academic degree, most of which is in philosophy. And then they go onwards to get their undergraduate degree. So anyhow, so yeah, so we opened 1959 as the Jesuit College. And then in the late 70s, when the number of students started to decline, they decided to open up a conference and retreat center. In addition, on our sixth floor, we have a Jesuit infirmary for retired Jesuit priests. So we currently have about 65 Jesuits that reside there now, and they still help out throughout the facility and with our retreats from men and women to youth groups. They do assist in confessions and performing Mass. So it's just a great place to work. And a lot of these men just have such a vast and fruitful background.
Well, you said, did you say six floors or?
Six floors. Okay. So the conference center, we're on four floors. We're on second, third, fourth, and fifth floors. And then on the fourth floor, on the east side of the building, is a healthcare center, which we have memory care, and then we have our residents that reside on 5 and 6 on the east wing. So the building is shaped like a cross. So on their east side of the building, we have that's where the Jesuits reside. They have their own dining area, their own lounge area, and then the main chapel is located in the center of the building. And on the west wing is where all the conference rooms and overnight rooms are located.
So this picture here, mm-hmm. Has any of the building parts been removed or anything like that? Or is it pretty much this?
Everything is original. Yes, everything's original. Yeah.
See, I didn't know that. That's mm-hmm. amazing.
Yes. Yeah, we're right on 400 acres, so.
Yeah, that's what I was talking about, the fact that you have this walking pathway and all this. It's mm-hmm. really wonderful. You even had mentioned that you guys have a pool that, you know, in the summertime that you have outdoors.
Yeah, so well, since it used to be a college, we have an athletic field, pool, just many recreation opportunities outside for meditation, yoga, walks. It's nice for the band camps. We have a lot of youth groups that do come in the summertime for camp, band camps, athletic high schools, like football camps and all that. So it's a good amenity for them to have.
And so where is it? The thing that I really liked about it is, you know, sometimes with retreats, people feel like they have to go so far away to mm-hmm. stay somewhere, and that becomes very costly because of travel expenses and everything. Mm-hmm. So I really like the location of it. So if you can just share, you know, where it's located. I mean, it's in Clarkston, but the way it's just seems like it's centered where you can get to it from anywhere, really, especially Metro Detroit.
Yeah, so we're located right off of I-75 in mm-hmm. Clarkston. So we're about 1.5 to 2 miles from the freeway. You wouldn't be able to tell, though, since we are tucked behind so much acreage. So it is nice for folks coming from Flint to Lansing to Detroit. It's a great centralized area for groups to come in from. So,
yeah, that's another thing that I did notice is that you're driving and here's this busy area, and then you drive in and it's like you're all secluded and it's nice and peaceful, and you just want to take your walks. And even I remember because when I came to do the interview, I brought my son along because they wanted me to do the story, but my son couldn't go to school that day or something about his school schedule. So I said, well, is it okay if I – oh, he was in preschool. So I said, can I bring him in? And then she's like, yeah, just, you know. But I – even found him, we would be walking down the hallway and he'll find certain interesting things, or he'd be staring out the window. So it's really a lovely place. And I think the fact that it has this kind of story probably has a lot to do with it. Don't you think that there's all that history behind it? Have you guys, I mean, I wonder, have you there been a book to write about it or anything like that that kind of shares some of this of Columbia's story?
You know, we really don't have a whole lot out there. You know, we're kind of just a hidden secret.
Yeah.
So, you know, a lot of our business, I guess, businesses is word of mouth. So a lot of people come there. And we've had groups that have been coming there for 20, 30 years. And it is a second home for them. They come in and they just feel at peace. They feel at home. They're getting away from their scurried, you know, their lives of just daily stress and busyness. And it's just a good place to get away and reflect and grow deeper with God, and or be there for whatever you know you're there for. We most recently had a porcelain artist group there. They're porcelain painters, to sewing retreats, to quilting retreats. So we're really open to everybody.
Mm-hmm.
But being as big as our facility is, we may house, you know, four different groups there at one time. So many times it is fun to see, you know, what groups we have there, and many times they interact with one another. And if they're there just wanting to concentrate on their own stay, workshop, or retreat, you know, we do set them apart from everyone else. But
are they mostly local, the people that come?
I would say most of the groups are coming at least a half hour away to an hour away on average.
Okay.
Because they want to go away from their typical surroundings, that, you know, in their daily life, and just get away for just some peace and just to get some individual time.
Well, that's wonderful that people invest into something like this, because it is very important with our schedules these days. It is very important.
Absolutely.
To get away, to disconnect. And again, like myself, I have been to similar places, but they've been sometimes out of the state.
Mm-hmm.
So when I was trying to decide where to do this, I thought, you know, I started finding different places that were available. And like I said, somebody suggested Columbia. And sometimes you take for granted what you have in your own state that you don't, or
me
even
too.
Just like it's literally, it was like a half hour, 45 minute drive from my house.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, wow, what a pleasant way to have something where you can gather community that have similar interests. And again, because of the retreat is called the Path of Consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
And I just felt like this was such a fitting place, because the space that is available, you know, just even sitting outside with nature. I know that you had mentioned, weather permitting, the picture of the fire ceremony. I think this is so. It has all these different aspects with nature where you can, you know, whether it's walking, whether it's the labyrinth, whether it's the yoga, just everything. Oops, this is.
And we do have walking trails throughout. We have one wooded walking trail that has the seven stations of the cross out there. It's about a mile and a quarter walk.
Mm-hmm.
But you do feel one with nature, not needing to be far away from the city at all. So yes, absolutely, the convenience of having a nearby retreat center, but also going there to focus on whatever you're there for.
Mm-hmm.
Which is always needed, you know, for everyday life.
Yes, it's always needed. That's true.
Mm-hmm.
Have you noticed that over time, has there been more people getting involved in retreats, or has it really just, and maybe we're not even aware that people are utilizing this, you know? I mean, so even though we started this particular retreat with the writing and spiritual retreat, but maybe this is something that people, for you said, like they've been utilizing it for over 20 years, but have you seen at all an increase, perhaps, in interest in that?
Yes, there's definitely been an increase. I think more people are finding that there is a need. I think people have gone away from it for a while.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, our primary business is youth, is high school, Kairos retreats, youth retreats, and then maybe the more, you know, women and older men and women's retreats.
Mm-hmm.
But I have felt like there's been a definite increase last decade for just either just, you know, any type of workshop at all, or you know, just a need, especially nowadays with the working women and families that are just getting busier and busier each year, just to get away for a short, you know, weekend stay is all they need to.
So what do you mean with regards to the families? Do people sometimes come just as family? Is there a limit on how many people can come and utilize it?
Yeah, our maximum capacity at Columbia is about 250 people. Uh-huh. We don't typically have, you know, young children there, but we do welcome it depending on what weekend and what we have going on. Uh-huh. But it's harder for parents to get away from their you know, their kids and work, and to spend a weekend away, it is important to do, but we are missing that millennial age group, you know, to get away and go on retreat. So the 20s to mid 30s, it's hard to get that age group to come on a weekend stay or just stay away for a bit. But I think now that we've been there for quite some time and people have found out about us, again, through word of mouth, we've definitely seen an increase in business.
You know, I just remembered when we came there, one of the ideas that came to me, I forgot because I always have too many ideas and I forgot about this. So I lead a Girl Scout troop. It's my daughter's troop.
Oh, yes.
And there's about 10 to 12 girls, mm-hmm. you know, that are in there. And so we do different activities. And I remember when I came in, you were explaining how I asked about this with regards to the age. And I thought, you know, what if I was to have some kind of an event where, you know, one of the things that we do is that if we want to have like camping or so we haven't done that. But I thought, what if we came to this place for a night or two and the daughters would come with their mothers? Mm-hmm. And I just, because I think even from a very young age, just being in these kind of environments where you're, and camping is also, of course, wonderful
sure.
for that with regards yes. to nature. But I think I was just so, I enjoyed the chapel and the outdoor, and it just felt like a less messier way
sure. no,
for us to be. So I thought about that, and then I forgot about this idea. Now when you were talking, I'm thinking, you know, I should bring it up to them because I never had the opportunity. I talked to mm-hmm. you about it, but I never had the opportunity to express this to the moms. And I know it's something that they would love mm-hmm. Because it really, the place, you know, with my children, I know this is happening, and I know with other children with regards to electronics, sometimes they get so involved with that, or even when you go on trips and there's you're in a hotel room and there's TVs, mm-hmm. and then that still maintains the distraction, and there's a lot of noise. And getting them introduced to a different, to more like a solitude, but not, you know, not like in a negative, you know, where they feel like they're so isolated
right.
in a beautiful way.
Yes.
They feel like it's seclusion, but it's very beautiful and it's very spiritual. So that's the reason I had thought about that. And now talking to you, I'm thinking I need to get back and kind of connect with the parents about that, because I think it's very healthy. The Girl Scouts in our troop, I mean, the youngest is 8, and then the others are all older. They're between like 12 and 13 years old. So I think mm-hmm. they would really have an appreciation for that.
Sure. Yeah. Actually, on Mother's Day, we are having a mothers and daughters weekend retreat. So they're having all fun activities, painting, just going outside, having, you know, some time over the campfire, and just bond, you know, just have a weekend away and bond with their daughters and mothers. And yes, the whole electronics and, you know, the internet and tablets. I mean, especially nowadays, it's hard for people to get away from, you know, their phones and it's good to be connected, but you know, not all the time. It's good
it's
to have a place. It's good to unplug and just focus on what's in front of you.
Yeah. So something like this with regards to the mother-daughter retreat, is that something that you guys sometimes have these kind of events, or it comes from an outside group that's putting it together? Do you guys ever have your own event that you're having?
Typically, it's an outside group. We don't facilitate anything ourselves. So mm-hmm. it's usually just an outside group wanting to put something together. Many times they want it to keep it closed, and other times they want to open it to the public. So if they want to open to the public, we typically ask the group if it's okay for us to place maybe a flyer on our website or on our social media site just to open it up to the public.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, and then I was interested, the nuns that I saw walking, are they, do they live there, or was this probably a group that was visiting?
It was
there?
Actually a group that was visiting, yes.
It was a group.
Yeah. Okay. And that's a fun part. You're always having something different there. You know, it's always different each week, which makes things fun, you know, mm-hmm. and But yes, there were a group that was there.
That was a group.
Yeah, was a group.
Okay, really cool. Yeah, I know that like I said, the Chaldeans that had hosted it there, they said, I don't know if they come in often, but they said, do they? Do they come
in? We do have two Chaldean groups that come in.
The women, it's a women's group or something like that?
This is young adult men and women, actually. We do have one coming up in I think at the end of May, a day group. I'm not sure if I should say who it is or not, but but they come in quite often.
Do they? Yeah. Okay, mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, that I wonder if it's one of the ones that I covered, because I know that, you know, I had the opportunity to interview the people that had come, and they really enjoyed it. They enjoyed the food, you know, the cafeteria. You guys cook everything, I believe.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah,
is that right?
We prepare and cook everything in-house. So we accommodate all special dietary requests, which nowadays you get a plethora of, you know, requests each week. So all of our pricing is very affordable, very economical for groups that are on a budget. And everything is priced per person. So it includes the meeting space, their overnight stay, the meals, beverage service. So you don't have to worry about, you know, going there and trying to figure out where to go to eat. And if people are leaving the facility to go to a restaurant to have their lunch, everything is right in the building.
And I think this was the other reason that you made it so much easier for us to make a quick decision, because first we were impressed about the setup of the building and mm-hmm. everything that was available. And then we too felt like we want to make this affordable, because a lot mm-hmm. of these retreats, which, like I said, I've gone to them, and they really go in the thousands sometimes. And, you know, and they're lovely. I mean, I would have never wanted not to experience them, but it seems like there's a limited number of people that can attend because of the price sometimes, or if it's far, because then you have to also put into factor the travel expenses.
Sure.
So we felt that what you guys were providing, and plus this was like 3-day course meals for the whole day. Well, we're having a conference and retreat. So people come in on Friday, October 5th, like around 4:00. And then they leave on Sunday afternoon. But Saturday, it's an all-day conference for mm-hmm. people that just want to come on Saturday and not stay there. And I remember when, you know, what you offered with 3 hot meals. And we had the chance to enjoy, you know, we experienced the food. So we had a taste of it. And we had lunch there. And thank you that you guys invited us for that. We really enjoyed it. So we thought, wow, we're offering something. We wanted to really offer something of value to people who want to utilize this, because sometimes the cost does get in the way of people enjoying it. But sure. We really didn't want to lower our standards. So at the same time, we didn't want to just mm-hmm. pick a place because it was like cheaper, but then it didn't really feel like the spiritual retreat that we want them to feel. And again, for myself as an author, you should, one day I'll have you come over and you'll see my house. But I put so much focus on my office area. Mm-hmm. I really create an environment because I think that's so important. I feel like life, it's not just about the writing process, but really your connection to God and your connection to what you're writing and who's going to be reading your material. And mm-hmm. the whole environment that you create around you helps you in the process of writing. You're learning and growing as a person. It's not just like, okay, because you're expressing yourself a certain way, but the combination of doing the spiritual and then the writing, and also because I had gone through a lot of like healing through my own writing and a lot of transformation, mm-hmm. and it was because of the people that I connected to provided these kind of environments in a lovely way, even if it was not in a physical sense. But I think anytime you get connected with, whether it's a building that has that essence in it, or whether people that have, it really transforms you regardless of what your career is. But I find that writing is very sacred. And I believe that writers, artists, they have filmmakers, they have a responsibility to what they're sharing with what you're putting out into the world. You know, are you putting something that's harmful or not? And that goes for people making food or yes. any. So mm-hmm. that was the, but, and then you feel like if somebody is being provided with really quality work or a very nice place to stay, and then they have to pay a very high price. And then there's a lot of people that get left out of from the process. What I liked about Colombia, it's really beautiful place at such an affordable price and so close to home. To have that kind of combination, I mean, so really, and that's part of the, I was very interested. Then it has a story.
Sure.
And as a storyteller, I'm always like, I'm so weak for that. Once I found out, what? It was built in 1959 and it has all the, you know, and the training for the priest. That became even more fascinating. But yeah, so that's why I had you come today to share the story and to let people know that it's available out there.
Yeah, it's available. And what's nice also is we're open to anyone. You know, people, you're a Catholic facility, but we really open our arms up to anyone that wants to come to utilize the facility. And it's just a great place to work. It's very peaceful. And it's just, it's nice to see when people leave after a weekend stay or leave after a week-long seminar. They just leave so much more refreshed and just, it's a new sense of themselves, too. They leave feeling, like, inspired with whatever they're there for. So that in itself is very rewarding.
And honestly, when I was there, I mean, besides the times that we came to look at the building and all around and you gave us a tour, but when I was writing a report when the other Chaldean group was there, a women's group was there, in the hours that I was there, that was the feeling that it gave me. So I hadn't even stayed the night and it gave me that kind of a feeling. So yeah, so we have, and every community has this. Every community has a very special place that they can go to, but they just have to, I guess because you guys keep it secret.
Right.
So you have to put some kind of effort to find it.
Right.
And yeah, I'm trying to, like, you know, make your secret known. I hope that's okay with you.
I appreciate that. Absolutely. Oh, okay. Absolutely.
That's
yeah,
good.
Really, I mean, we're searchable on the internet. You know, we keep up with our social media sites. But yeah, a lot of it is just, it's an interesting building. You know, again, we have the retirement center for priests. And then we did have a rehab center there for about 30 years that closed back in 2012. So we had a rehab center. We have an infirmary for priests. We had a conference center. So we had so much going on there that, you know, there wasn't a clear understanding. You know, people didn't really understand what we were, what we did. So, again, a lot of it is just word of mouth and people just searching retreat centers in the area. And there's quite a few. We're able, again, to keep our rates a little bit lower because we don't have a minimum number of people. We do have 4 floors. We do have a lot of space.
Yeah, that's another thing.
It is a
you don't have
facility.
That many restrictions. That's another thing. It's I noticed you don't have that many restrictions, even with how long a person stays. And you just made it so much so comfortable for a person to create, to do a group coming there. And again, I need to remember to talk to the Girl Scouts parents.
Absolutely.
But, well, anyway, it's, unfortunately, we're out of time, but thank you so much to sharing the story. And for anybody who wants to experience this, check out their website, or if there's going to be, like I said, the writing and spiritual retreat, which is going to have different speakers and different ways. It's not just going to be, you know, there's going to be some activities as we're going. When you showed the different classrooms, it was like, oh, well, the second floor has this and the third floor. We literally got lost.
Yeah. You really could have, you know, rooms anywhere from 10 people up to 250.
Oh, my God, yeah.
So there's just a wide range
well,
of options.
Well, not going to be that big. Well, I don't know. But anyway, but if people want to come to the, it's called the Path of Consciousness, and they can check out, like, the prices in there. It's going to be October 5th to 7th. But for anything else, check out the Colombier.com.
Colombier.com.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you so much, Virginia.
Thank you.
Thank you.